DE354, Torpedogeschwindigkeit 30.
Fertig.
Rohr 1
ist
fertig.
Rohr 1.
Los!
More than 30 U-boats were certainly destroyed in the month of May, foundering in many cases with their crews into the dark depths of the sea. Staggered by these deadly losses, the U-boats have recoiled to lick their wounds and mourn their dead.
By 1943, the tides were turning against the U-boats thanks to British intelligence and the long-range American Liberator bomber. But in the South Pacific, the Japanese submarines were wreaking havoc on Allied convoys, which carried the weapons and men of war. During World War II in the Pacific, the U.S. Navy was confronted with a supply problem unprecedented in history. To provide desperately needed material to its ships at sea and at bases all over the broad Pacific, the Navy went into the exporting business on a large scale. At U.S. ports, the equipment and supplies bound for American fighting men in the Asiatic theater were prepared for shipment. The Navy was only able to deliver these supplies thanks to the new improved Destroyer Escort, predecessor of the earlier design. In July of 1942, the High Command set forth on construction of over 500 new DEs as American shipyards worked in a round-the-clock effort. The new Destroyer Escort was a complement of sophisticated communications, speed, sonar, and increased firepower. This is the story of one of these escort ships, the George E. Davis, DE-357, commanded by Lieutenant Commander Frederick L. Lincoln. The construction of the Davis began in February of 1944 in Orange, Texas, and she was launched less than 2 months later on April 8th, sponsored by Mrs. Davis, the widow of George E. Davis, who was killed in action aboard the cruiser Houston in 1942. The Davis was armed with triple torpedo tubes, 5-inch guns, 20 and 40 millimeter guns, depth charge racks, and the new Hedgehog anti-submarine launchers. The Davis was fast, with two turbine twin screws. The low streamlined design was a difficult target for enemy submarines. Let's take a look now back into naval history, to life on a destroyer in the Pacific, and relive some of the most memorable moments for the 215 officers and crew, starting at the beginning. Boot Camp 1944. The crew of the Davis and other escort ships during the war were trained at basic training camps across the United States, where the training was tough and the hours were long. After their first wave of training, the crew were assembled in Norfolk for training in June of 1944 pursuant to commissioning. The men were trained on the specific duties characteristic to a destroyer escort at sea. The next stop, Orange, Texas. The crew arrived to meet their new ship on August 5, 1944 in Orange, Texas for pre-commissioning detail. The ship and the crew were spick and span for the commissioning on August 11th. The men proudly posed for this historic event. These are the pictures of the various divisions that made the ship function. The officers were ultimately in charge of the ship and crew, and often looked after the younger swabbies to ensure safety aboard ship and ashore. The deck force would be responsible for the maintenance and appearance of the ship. The yeomen would serve as the record keepers aboard ship. The sonar men were trained to detect submarines listening to reflected echoes from sea. The radar men would be the watchdogs of the skies and sea. The signalmen were trained as experts at communication with radio silent flashing lights and signal flags. The quartermasters knew the position of the ship at every instant and charted new courses. The radio men were monitoring for messages, both friend and foe. The water tenders were responsible for maintaining the ship's boilers. The machinist mates were responsible for the ship's engine room. The job of converting salt water to fresh would be performed by the evaporator men, while the electricians provided constant power. These and many others behind the scenes were the foundation for the crew of a destroyer escort ship. After the ceremonies were complete, it was time to shove off for trials off Bermuda. Everything functioned according to plan, and she set sail back to the mainland. After a brief stop in Boston and Norfolk, she set sail southward for destinations unknown to the crew on October 21st. Conditions aboard a destroyer escort on the high seas were wet and rugged, and many of the men fell to seasickness, being their first time on the high seas. In the Pacific, United States Marine amphibious units were flushing the Japanese off each island in a series of bloody campaigns. Naval units often softened up the beaches with aerial barrages prior to the Marine invasions, as destroyer escorts provided protection. The Davis arrived in the war-torn Pacific on October 28th after a brief stop in Cologne on the Atlantic side of the Panama Canal. At 9:35 a.m., the ship crossed the equator. This was an exhilarating experience for any sailor. The men celebrated on deck with the traditional Royal Order of Shellback's initiation. The men who had never crossed the equator were considered polywogs and had to go through the age-old traditions of all sailors crossing the equator. It was a harrowing and exhausting initiation. On the Davis, the ship's electricians constructed a custom electric chair, while the ship's galley prepared a foul-tasting drink. The ship's barbers performed some of the most bizarre haircuts. The dunk tank was next, and it was a joyous celebration for all. Even the ship's captain was initiated. Prior to reaching the destinations of Hollandia on New Guinea, the ship island hopped for supplies at Santa Cruz, Bora Bora, and Espirito Santos. On November 28th, the Davis reached her port of call at Hollandia, where things were fairly calm and they were greeted by the local Hollandia welcoming committee. But there was a constant threat of danger, especially at the next port of call. Leyte Gulf, the Philippines. The Davis was ordered to escort convoys between Hollandia and Leyte Gulf in the Philippines, the scene of one of the largest naval battles of the war. Just 2 months prior to the arrival of the Davis in Leyte Gulf, the Japanese held the Philippines in full force. The Japanese knew the loss of the Philippines would cut them off from their southern resource area in Southeast Asia and dispatched Operation Sho, a naval armada force of 4 carriers, 2 battleships, 3 light cruisers, and 8 destroyers to annihilate the American amphibious force and marine units already beached and advancing on the mainland. On October 24th, the American 7th Fleet fought off the Imperial Navy as amphibious forces advanced on the islands. American control of this small gulf and its surrounding islands was a major stepping stone in the push toward Japan. With a strong base in the Philippines secure, the U.S. Navy could begin reinforcing the troops in the push northward. Fresh supplies and materials were desperately needed, so the Davis and other naval units were assigned convoy duty to the Gulf. She made her first arrival on December 12th, escorting 21 ships. The liberation of Manila by American forces and Philippine guerrillas provided an opportunity for the men to go ashore on liberty. In the Philippines, the men were warmly greeted by the local people, who were in good spirits despite their war-torn living conditions. The men experienced the devastation of war firsthand as the harbor was riddled with wrecks, including a Japanese midget submarine. While at sea, numerous general quarters were sounded as the increased kamikaze activity began in Japan's last-ditch effort to turn the tides of the war. It was the morning of New Year's Day, 1945.
General Porter, on the double.
The men of the Davis had their first kill. An enemy torpedo plane, which attacked at 0900 hours and was destroyed. The big band sounds temporarily took the war off the minds of the servicemen and civilians alike in 1945. On board the Davis, in between the watches, the men found time to relax, listening to music or watching movies in the mess hall at night. They also enjoyed playing cards and just plain relaxing. There was plenty of time to read mail, a precious cargo for the Navy morale, delivered ship to ship, or via short pickup details on the various islands. While on various islands, the men had many beer parties. Nothing like a cold beer on the hot tropical islands. Another favorite pastime was a visit to the memorable Temptation nightclub. Other memorable moments for the men occurred on subsequent patrols, where the Davis rescued an American LCT ship in distress on January 26th. Another memorable moment for the men was a visit to Corregidor, where a few solemn words were spoken on deck for the men who lost their lives there. Ashore, the men came in contact with the enemy as Japanese prisoners were marched by. But soon the Davis would be on another dangerous patrol, as a few hundred miles away, American forces were landing on Okinawa. Just 360 miles from the coast of Japan, Okinawa was the last and bloodiest battle of the war, as every inch of the island was hotly contested. In the meantime, kamikaze raids were carried on round the clock. In a combined effort, the Navy and Amphibious Marine Divisions were able to take the island in 82 days, with considerable casualties of men, equipment, and ships. The Davis arrived off the shores of Okinawa on July 21st, escorting a convoy of seven ships. For 3 days, the Davis conducted picket duty in Buckner Bay, searching for subs while dodging kamikazes in the same waters that many other destroyers had been previously sunk. Soon after Okinawa fell and the Japanese surrendered on August 15th, the Davis sailed to Nagasaki, arriving September 15th with a convoy of occupational troops. She continued escort duties along the East China Sea, supporting American and Chinese nationalists during the reoccupation of China. There were several stops in Tsingtao and Shanghai, exciting ports of call for the men. While in Shanghai, a small puppy was adopted by the crew to serve as the ship's mascot and properly named after that city. The ship was dry docked briefly for barnacle scraping duty. Soon, the Davis was found performing numerous goodwill tours of the Philippines. Orders came to head home on April 15th, 1946. Returning to Hawaii proved to be a well-deserved liberty for the men. The Davis had survived the war with only one small casualty, the loss of the whaleboat while attempting to transport sick crew member Salvador Greco ashore in Manila Harbor. The George E. Davis was recommissioned for naval training during the Korean War before being mothballed in Green Cove Springs, Florida. Her final resting place was ironically where it all began, Orange, Texas. The mighty George E. had come full cycle. She was stricken from the register in 1972 and scrapped, but she still sails on in the hearts of the men who served her, men who risked their lives for the dreams of a peaceful tomorrow.